All right, so today we are going to talk about our 4.1 vocabulary for our forces and energy section. So now up until this point, we've spent a lot of time talking about forces, and we've been telling you that this whole unit is forces and energy, so now it makes sense that we're getting to our energy piece. And so with that, energy is the ability to do work or cause change, and we measure it in joules. An example of energy is putting a book in your backpack. Right, so really all energy is the ability to do work. So if it has the ability for work to occur, then there's energy, and we measure that, and this is joules. Okay, so a lot of people want to say, oh, well, that's joules. It's pronounced joules. It's named after a French physicist, and so that's why we call it joules, because that's how you pronounce that name. Our next word is going to be kinetic energy. So we just kind of defined what energy is, and now we can define energy in two categories, the first one being kinetic energy. So kinetic energy is energy that an object has due to its motion. Okay, so if there's an object that's moving, it's gonna have kinetic energy. If it's not moving, it won't have kinetic energy, and it's really that simple. Swinging a hammer does work on a nail as it drives the nail into a piece of wood. Okay, so if we have this, you can imagine this hammer we have here moving down and striking onto this nail here. And then that nail is going to then now move into the wood or whatever surface that we are trying to nail it into. And so this hammer is going to have kinetic energy as we swing it down. And really what causes this nail then to go in is, well, there's that energy being transferred as it hits. Just like many of you have looked at the Newton's cradle that I have, as we drop the one side, each one of those metal spheres hits the next, and it's transferring that energy, and that's why the one moves on the other side. Now our next word is going to be potential energy. So I mentioned there's two ways in which we can categorize energy, and so we just mentioned kinetic. The next one's going to be potential. Now potential energy is the energy an object has because of its position. Also, the internal stored energy of an object, such as energy stored in chemical bonds. So potential energy can be classified in a couple different ways. The main thing is it has the potential to turn into kinetic energy, to be kind of release that energy. So the example that I have for you is when you compress a spring by winding a toy, you have transferred energy to it. It might be used later if the spring unwinds. So with potential energy, and we'll talk about actually, we'll get there. But basically it's the potential for energy to be released. And so in this example here, if we had this spring and we went in and we pushed it, we compressed it, then, well, you guys know, as you compress the spring, if you suddenly take away that compression, it unwinds or springs out, and it could launch an object, right? And that's that energy. It's being stored until it's able to be released. All right, so this is what I was talking about earlier, but I decided to wait till we actually got to the word. Potential energy now can also be split into a couple of different categories. Now with those categories, we have the first one being gravitational potential energy. So as the name implies, it's going to have something to do with our gravity and the potential it has for energy. Potential energy that depends on the height of the object. So basically, as we lift an object up off of the ground or whatever surface it could fall to, it increases in potential energy. So we use an equation: gravitational potential energy equals the weight times the height. Okay, so that means our weight, remember, is going to be something in newtons, because that's the unit we use for weight, and our height then is going to be meters, because a newton times a meter is what equals a joule. So a book has a weight of 10 newtons. If the book is moved 2 meters off the ground, the book has 10 newtons times 2 meters, or 20 joules, of gravitational potential energy. Okay? And that's really what we have. And so if we had this go even higher, then maybe, say, it went up to 4 meters, it would have more gravitational potential energy. As our height increases, the distance we get from our floor over here, the greater our gravitational potential energy. The greater our weight, the greater our gravitational potential energy. So basically, as both of these increase, so as each one of these, actually let me get it right, as this goes up and this goes up as well, they're directly related. All right, so now the next and final word, although make sure you keep watching when I'm done with this word, because I'm going to kind of give you a nice little image about how these all kind of are categorized, a better visual, we have is elastic potential energy. Now, if you think, before we even get over here to the definition in this example, elastic, if you think something that's elastic, a lot of you probably think of a rubber band, and that's truly my favorite example of elastic potential energy, because it's really simple and you guys know how rubber bands work. Another one is a trampoline, which is what I actually use in my example here. So, all simply put, it's the energy of stretched or compressed objects. So a spring would be an example of elastic potential energy. A rubber band, if we stretch it, that's elastic potential energy. If you think about it, you take a rubber band and you pull it back and you launch it across the room, which you should never do in my classroom, that's an example of elastic potential energy. Okay, as you pull back on that rubber band, it's storing energy, and as you release it, right, you know, typically the further you pull it back, the farther that rubber band will go, because more energy is stored. You know, if you only pull it back a little bit, it doesn't travel a very far distance. So our example here, now, this is a really long example, and that's a lot to write. You do not have to write all of this, okay? What I would for sure want you to write is starting here and going to here. That's the piece at a minimum you have to write. The other before stuff is simply a way to further explain the situation. However, that's a lot for you to write in the space provided, so I do not expect you to write this rather large paragraph. But let's read it. When a kid presses down on a trampoline, the trampoline changes shape. The trampoline now has potential energy. When the kid pushes off of the trampoline, the stored energy sends the kid upward. Objects such as a trampoline and bungee cord have elastic potential energy. Okay, and then that's why over here we have our example of our kid jumping on a trampoline, and you guys often know how trampolines work. Now, there's really a couple of different areas in which is that elastic potential stored. It's stored in the springs here on the side. They kind of stretch out, and then when they pull back, that helps pull this kind of nylon tarp up, and that also has a little bit of stretch to it, as you know, so that also stores some energy. And basically, as it bends, then it changes shape, and it stores that energy, and then eventually, as you kind of stop pushing down, it'll launch you up, and now it's giving you a bit kinetic energy, right? Because now it's causing you to move upward, and now it's converting that energy from potential to kinetic, and that's something we'll spend a lot of time working on in this unit. All right, so here is our little graphic showing how these energies kind of fit in with each other. So we have, just in general, we have energy. Then we have kinetic energy, so we have this branching. So we have, remember I said there's really these two types. There's kinetic energy, and then there's potential energy. And then I said, we can really narrow down potential energy a little bit further into elastic potential energy and gravitational potential energy. Kinetic energy for now is just its own thing. We just specifically look at the movement of things. And if it's moving, it has anything moving, it has kinetic energy. We can get potential energy a little more specific, because remember, gravitational potential energy is dealing with the height that the object is. So if it's going to be able to fall, or so like a skydiver has a lot of that potential energy because they're very, very high up. And then there's elastic potential energy, looks more at compressing or stretching specific objects and looking at how that energy is stored. So we can get potential energy a little more detailed. So we have this extra split here to indicate that. And then they're all forms of energy, which means every single one, it doesn't matter whether it's kinetic or it's potential, it's measured in joules. Okay, so that's the big thing you gotta remember now. It's the new unit, and that's joules. Okay, which is basically telling us the amount of force over a given amount of space or distance, sorry. And that wraps up our 4.1 forces and energy video. Thanks for watching.